This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're going to be talking to someone I am amazed I have never had on this show, never been on Coast all these years. I've known my guest for many, many, many years, and is a lovely guy, and he's going to have a friend with him, Ryan Keaton. And if you're on Unknown Country at all, you'll know that Ryan is daily live streaming on Facebook his efforts to film or tape UFOs and having a lot of success at it. And as it's John Martin and others are also having a lot of success with it. So, you know, I'm interested in more people trying this because apparently it's now not hard to do if you're patient, dedicated, and if you have some kind of mental interaction. We're going to be talking about all of that. I'd like to introduce my two guests now. We're going to welcome John Browilke and Ryan Keaton to Dreamland. I'm so glad to have you guys on. And John, I apologize. It's been way too long. John has a new book out. It's called The Solar Obliteration Experiment. It is a very excellent description of what he has done in his life and how he got started in this and exactly what it is he does do. And then we're going to be talking at the same time to Ryan about what he's doing. So let's get started. Let's start with you, John. And how did you get into this in the beginning? Tell us a little bit about your background. You're in the military at one point. Tell us about that and then how you suddenly became interested in UFOs or they became interested in you.
Oh, yes. Well, Willie, there's some parallels I think you might recognize, but as I went along my path, I have found that it's very possible that these things have been in my life since the beginning. I might be a second or third generation experiencer, but I've done a lot of shows, and when people ask me to talk about my book, it would take an hour and a half just to, tell the beginning. So I want to truncate this for you the best I can. And before we leave, I want to make two personal notes to Whitley. But my first job out of high school was I was a engine mechanic on fighter jets, F-15s, out of Eglin Air Force Base in Florida. Now, no one had really heard about this in the media at that time, but we had a house off base, a couple of friends of mine, in a little place called Gulf Breeze. Maybe Whitley will recognize, without any knowledge of what that meant.
One of the premier UFO hotspots of America in the 90s. Yeah, absolutely.
And I was there probably 5 or 6 years before, I think it was Ed Walters had taken his amazing pictures. And we literally would spend a lot of time on that beach where he took some of his really dramatic zero-point energy spheres. And to this day, I find Mr. Walters' videos to be amongst some of the most amazing that I have seen. Now, also, I want to interject, during this time when I was in the Air Force, I would be my unit, the 59th out of the 33rd Tactical Fighter Wing. We go on TDYs a lot, and I did get a chance to go out to Nellis Air Force Base for the Red Flag. And to make a long story as short as I can, due to some airmen having too much fun at the casinos and stuff, they decided to put us in barracks. Well, this is the story they told us, to make sure we get to work on time and not be intoxicated, I guess. And they put us on a bus, took us way out in the middle of nowhere to this big gate by a mailbox. And when we went to the gate, the bus would be entered by a bunch of fellows with machine guns and looking at us very closely. But it was in a place that at the time they referred to the Dry Lake or the Grim Lake, the S4. And I really didn't see anything remarkable there, except I've spoken on some other shows, and I said that I had seen a drone, a UAP, whatever, before people had known about drones. At the time, they referred to the Dark Star. This is not a Top Gun reference. I want to straighten that out because I've taken some flack for that comment. But it was just a small, looked like a flying saucer that had detachable wings on it. And it was just a drone. I also saw a amazing demonstration of a laser cannon. Besides that, I didn't find anything remarkable about that. And I want to say probably 10 years or so after that, 7 or 8 years, I was living in Hollywood.
Well, here's another. Hold on. Yes. We just passed by a flying saucer and a laser cannon in a few seconds. And
you well, these are top secret things.
Just hold on. Let me ask my question. Tell us first. Now, you say drone flying saucer. Did you know for certain that it was our drone or not?
Well, it was in a hangar, and I was taken into a place that the world had not heard of by then. And I'm like trying not to go off into the weeds. I was getting to that. But nowadays, people know it as Area 51.
Right.
And there was no good reason why a friend of mine and a co-worker were taken to look at an engine, a jet engine on a stand, just to verify that there was oil in the tank. It really didn't make any sense, but I got a couple hours off, you know, during doing the red flag exercises with the 59th Squadron out of Eglin. And as we're walking down this tarmac by these old, it looked like a World War II or a Korean War era facility. I looked into a hangar and saw it looked like a black flying saucer with wings clipped on, standing on wheels. And nobody told us not to look over. I didn't think anything of it, but it looked pretty cool. And they called it the Dark Star. Again, this was way before, you know, Top Gun, Maverick, where the Dark Star Aurora jet is flying. There's nothing like it. It was a drone before people had ever heard about it. And then I saw a C-130 flying out over a range that shot a laser cannon through a lens, and it hit what looked like a workhouse or outhouse. And it just evaporated instantly into a steam. It looked almost like a magician's bad, you know, magic trick or something. My point on bringing that up is entering Area 51, as they call it, that was the most extreme thing that I saw. And I completely forgot about it.
Just hold on. Hold on. Okay, so you have seen a drone or flying saucer in a hangar long before drones were something that anyone outside of the secret world knew about. You've seen a laser cannon being fired.
Yes.
Yeah, and this is 81?
1981, I believe. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, a laser cannon being fired, and a few years later, there would be pulsed beam weapons fired at UFOs toward that were near shuttle mission STS-48 out of Pine Gap in
Australia.
In Australia, yeah. And oddly enough, I know the person who probably was one of the people who was very responsible for creating these things. So it's a small world, isn't it? And folks, I'll go into him a little bit more in my book, Them, which is going to be out soon. Don't worry, it's nearly finished. I know my friends are telling me I've been saying that Them was nearly finished for 6 months. Well, that's true. But it is actually at the proofreaders right now, I hasten to add. Okay. Now, so you've seen these things.
Well, my point was we've had this technology for a long time, and they don't even admit to it now.
And, well, right, exactly. And who knows whose it was. I mean, were we flying the object that was in the hangar or not? We don't know.
Well, it really looked like just a piece of hardware that they, you know, didn't look like an alien capture or anything. It completely was human technology, in my opinion. And it had wings clipped onto it. And when this thing takes off, as it raises into the air, it drops the wings almost like a water skier will drop one of their skis when they want to slalom ski, right?
Mm-hmm. So it wasn't a conventional UFO as we see in the public.
I only brought that up because of the name originally was the Dark Star. And I want to say about 6 or 7 years after that, I was in Hollywood and I saw a television broadcast from this fella out of Las Vegas who announced the first time I ever heard of Area 51. And I just casually thought, that's funny. I believe I've been there. This George Knapp fellow, maybe you know him.
I know George very well. Well, listen, hold on a minute, John. Yes. Folks, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a brief break, and please follow the instructions that we will lay out for you enticingly, I hope, and subscribe to unknowncountry.com. John is a subscriber and a recent subscriber, and he's enjoying himself a lot. I think Kevin is on the site too. I'm not sure. But in any case, it's worth doing because there's no other place in the world like it, folks. There's no other community like it. All right, we'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to John Bro Wilkie, and in a minute we'll also be talking to Ryan Keaton, who is live streaming his UFO sightings through Facebook nightly. And we were just talking before about John's early experiences at Groom Lake, which sort of might have created a bit of an interest in UFOs, but there's something more that happened then. And that now we go back to October the 27th, 1994, about 12 or 13 years after your experiences at Groom Lake. You're working as a construction contractor or with a construction contractor, and you see something. You see something. Where are you? You're in Glendale, right, California.
Yeah. Bear with me. My allergies are kicking me here. Excuse me. So anyways, yeah, we're jumping forward. I wanted to interject this story first from when George Knapp came on TV and announced that. I went to bed that night and had some amazing dreams. And I started to remember a lot of things that had been almost as if they were removed from my memory. You can get into that later or at all if you wish. But in 1994, you know, early in the year, we had that great earthquake in Los Angeles, and I was right on top of it. It's just indescribable what that experience was. I didn't realize that I could be so scared. So I was with a coyote construction worker, somebody that doesn't have their license, but, you know, people hire him for a discount. He's very good. And but I was talking for some reason about UFOs a lot, and he was angry at me this morning. He was that morning telling me that my job would be in jeopardy because he was fearing my sanity might not be there. And so he went into the Builder's Emporium, I think you guys call them in California, y'all. I stayed out on a picnic table having a hot dog, clear blue sky, and the first thing that I saw was a falling star going from west to east, but I tracked it for about 3 miles. And when it got over the Glendale, over by Dodger Stadium, Chavez Ravine, it slowed down and started doing a corkscrew motion. And to the best of my knowledge, that is not possible with a falling star. And I shouldn't be seeing them in, you know, at 10:30 in the morning or whatever. So I'm livid. I'm fit to be tied, as they say. My boss came out. I wanted so bad to tell him, but we had just had that conversation. We get in the van. He turns on the radio, and there's a story about this young lady, pilot, twin engine, I think it was a Cherokee or something, that she had lost power in both of her engines and dead stick landed this plane in the infield at Dodger Stadium. And I'm thinking, I just watched this happen. And in the interview, they had a short interview, and the lady said she just saw a flash over her cockpit, and both engines simultaneously went out. I believe Ryan knows this. I have a background with aircraft, obviously, and these are independent systems. They are not dependent on one another. One going out would not take out the other. The only thing I know that could do that would be an EMP.
So you actually saw some kind of an effect on an aircraft. I mean, yes, you have been around, John. I'm telling you,
it's just the beginning.
Now, Ryan, let me just shift to you now for a few minutes.
Yes, sir.
And ask you how you came to start doing this. What drew you into this crazy world of ours?
I've always been interested in the sky and looking at stars and everything else. I think it drew me into it. I think there was, I had walked outside of my house one night, looked out, I had seen something that looked like a star, but the way it twinkled just didn't look right. I looked out, my wife came out, she looked at it and she goes, yeah, that's kind of odd. And I looked out behind me, behind the house here, and there was something else kind of looked like it was in the sky, but it was like floating almost like it was a boat in water. And, you know, as time went on for the first couple of weeks there, you know, I thought I was losing my mind.
When was this?
This was about 7 months ago.
7 months ago. And was there anything in your life that would have started this up? I mean, were you reading about UFOs or talking about them at all?
I've been really into like Bob Lazar and George Knapp. You know, I've watched some of the Joe Rogan stuff with some of that. And I've always been interested like in the sky and, you know, UFOs, but I've never personally seen anything. So when I saw something in the sky, I'm extremely curious and, I want to figure out what's up there. So that's got me into, you know, wanting to take pictures. And then, you know, as of lately, the live stream stuff.
So it drew you in a subtle way.
Yes.
And now, the question that is going to be on the lips of everybody who goes to the live stream, and you'd be able to do that through Unknown Country. It'll be linked on the Dreamland show page. But John always puts in the comments area when it's happening. And
yes.
When do you usually do it, Ryan?
I'm doing it 5-6 nights a week, weather permitting. A lot of the times I can see some stuff on the ground, but most of the activity I see, I need it to be, you know, not as cloudy.
Right.
So I try to do it 5-6 times a week, as much as possible. It's one of the things that I really enjoy. I've had the past few years of my life personally has been kind of rough. So this has kind of given me some kind of a purpose. You know, as I've recognized over the past few months or so, is there's not a lot of younger people that seem to be out doing this stuff. And
yeah,
I really enjoy it. And I want to share it with the world. I don't want to keep it for myself. I want everyone to kind of, you know, enjoy it like I am. And, you know, that was the point of starting the live, is I want people to come out. I've had people come out with me on my lives. I had a couple come out a few weeks ago. We're planning something, here in the next few weeks, where I'm going to try to get a group of us together and start going out and sky watching. And, you know, it kind of helps because I've kind of seen some stuff and I know some spots that I've been going to occasionally. And that's where I'm going to start. I want to kind of start a movement where everybody's doing it. And, you know, kind of.
Yeah.
Pass on the torch.
I think that's an important part of this. And I think it's one of the main reasons you guys are here, because we can do this. And if the more we do it, I think the better we're going to maybe make contact work. And Free Dreamlander, speaking of making contact work, come into contact with us. You can actually get involved in this. You can not be passive to it. You can become active. You could go out there and do this.
Mm-hmm.
Subscribers could too. We'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get communion. Listen to it. Read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young. I believe that it was kind of blonde, and he was very tall, like at least six feet, and he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today. This is Whitley Strieber. It's Dreamland. We're talking to John Bro Wilkie and Ryan Keaton about UFOs and seeing UFOs and actually filming UFOs on a regular basis. Melinda Leslie, John Martin both do this on a regular basis. Melinda has been doing it for years out in Sedona. John does it in Georgia. We've had John on the show, and you know he plays his guitar and sits out on his deck and films them, and they're really, what he films are completely indisputable. I mean, they're not passing satellites. Now, I want to ask you, Ryan, how you identify these. In other words, there's lots of satellites flying around out there, and it's easy to make a mistake. What tells you that that's not what you're taping?
Well, I use, I've got binoculars, telescopes. I have the flight radar app. And whenever I'm out doing this stuff, I'm going to try to find a logical explanation for what I'm seeing. And that's real important to me. Of course I make mistakes. I'm still new to this. I'm learning, and that's a good reason, why me and John have been out, and he's kind of helped mentoring me, because there is times where you get overly excited and you want it to be a certain thing, but you kind of got to learn how to put a brake pedal on yourself and make sure that you're screening all your stuff. Make sure you're looking at your flight radar, looking through your binoculars, and trying to find find a logical explanation for this stuff before you actually say, hey, look, this is probably an unidentified object.
Now, the unidentified objects show up often enough for you to justify live streaming your efforts.
Yes. It's been every night for 6-7 months.
And I, you know, I forgot to ask you exactly where you are. I don't think all of our listeners know.
I'm on the northwest side of San Antonio, off of, I don't know if people are familiar with Government Canyon at all.
But I'm I grew up in San Antonio.
Yeah. I'm right there by Government Canyon. So I see a lot of my activity. It's over Government Canyon, kind of going back towards Camp Bullis, in that area. And that's another reason why this has got me really involved. As soon as I started going down and started doing some research on Government Canyon itself, and then
tell us a little bit about it.
So Government Canyon back in the late 1800s was actually a military outpost. And then in 95, I believe it was, there are several entities that bought out Government Canyon. And what it actually is, it was supposedly for the aquifer and trying to save it because this area of San Antonio is growing so big. And they wanted to preserve and make sure that the water would stay clean in this area. But what was strange is they didn't open it to the public until 2005. And I have a friend of mine that went out there, and I've been out to Government Canyon too, but there's signs out there that if you go out to the north, northeast of Government Canyon, there's trails on Government Canyon, but there is no trails that go back on that side of Government Canyon. I've learned that there's the huge cave system underneath there. And then as I was learning about that, I came across, there's a news station in San Antonio that's been trying to get onto Camp Bullis for Camp Stanley. And Camp Stanley is actually is believed to be the largest weapons depot for the CIA in the nation. And as, you know, I kept reading, kind of doing some research, there are some people that believe that Camp Stanley actually has an underground base. And it just kind of clicked in my head, you know, as I'm watching some of these other people when they talk about unidentified flying objects, is, you know, the CIA seems to have some kind of plug in that somehow, whether it be otherworldly or if it's just the military, who knows? I have no idea. And that's one of the big things I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah, well, you're not alone. I'm trying to figure out those things too. There was a, back in the 60s, there was an explosion out that way, an atomic explosion when an atomic artillery shell accidentally detonated. Wow. And it was somewhere near Government Canyon. My guess is those signs are there not to warn people away from radiation, because they're not going to do that, but to warn people away from, to try to prevent people from going up in the area where there may still be residual radiation. When that happened, the explosion was noticed all over San Antonio. It was in the newspapers, and after a short time, men in what we now know are hazmat suits with Geiger counters started coming through my neighborhood, checking for fragments of plutonium. And so it was quite an event. And subsequently, we were always told that Camp Stanley was abandoned. And it's not. Mm-hmm. Never was. So it's a real interesting area that you're in. I can well understand. Another thing, limestone, this whole region from south of San Antonio, all the Hotel Edwards Aquifer region is basically limestone. You know, another great area of limestone in the world is in England, where the crop circles are formed. There's something about limestone, I don't know what, that sort of attracts all of this. So I can well understand now your interest and your success. It makes a lot of sense. So, John, let's go back to you now, if we can. And you now have a long life in this. And let's talk about the book. Let's talk about solar obliteration and your first solar obliteration experiments. First, tell us what it is And then I'm going to briefly describe my own experiences with this, which I have had very surprisingly. But tell us what solar obliteration is, how you found it, and how why it is you think you are filming genuinely anomalous objects when you do this.
Well, I want to interject an idea here, Whitley, that the book is, it's really about not claiming, but it's the documentation of an urban legend, you know, because I'm not demanding anyone believe what I say.
But we can't do that yet. Yes. We're not in that position, none of us are. So, yeah, I agree.
I have an old saying that I just made up, that if you open a window into another realm, it just makes sense that whatever is on the other side of that curtain feels a breeze.
Well said, John. Very well said.
For me, the UFO phenomenon is kind of like the gateway drug to other paranormal things too. And my point is, my experience was when you see it, whatever it is, it has a tendency to like come closer to you or see you too. And I'm getting off in the weeds here, but Ryan came up from San Antonio about a week ago to meet me personally. And we did a live stream, nothing much happened. But on the way home, I got the hell scared out of me, and I had one of the most amazing, experiences of my life in this field. So, anyways, I want to jump back to.
No, wait a minute.
Yeah,
you can't just tell us you had one of the most and then jump back. Give us the experience and then jump back.
Well, and I have a reason why I bring this. I'm so proud of Ryan for being the next generation to. Come into this, because in my day, Whitley, everybody knew your story, and but nowadays everybody for a couple of years knew my story, but nowadays people really, it hasn't carried over. It's a generational jump, right? So almost by fate, by synchronicity, I know you don't really believe in that, by one of your podcasts.
No, wait a minute. I don't say I don't believe in synchronicity. I just had big show on synchronicity, and I do very much believe in it.
I was making kind of a pun because I watched your podcast. Very interesting. And it just seems fated that I met Ryan. But we were down by a place called Stillhouse Hollow Lake, just south of Harker Heights, which is adjacent to Killeen, just south on the border of Fort Hood. You can expect just about anything out of there. And it's not unusual for me to hear tank practice at my home here in Killeen. So we did the live stream. It was kind of chilly out there and windy. Nothing really much of note happens. He finds a lot of his things in capturing individual stills, even more so, because you can skywatch for hours and get skunked. It's like fishing, right? So we decided to call it a day. We drive south out of this little park right by the bridge. And I happened to look up, and it was a clear sky. And I saw something that looked to me like, I just commented, not even thinking about it, that it looks like there's a delta-shaped cloud. And then we made a sharp left 90-degree turn, and we went a couple miles down the road. And I saw it again, almost like it was pacing us. I don't know the orientation of this area. But, it was a delta is not an acute triangle. It is a very precise, it fits within the Fibonacci curve. It's a ratio almost like pi, 3.1 to 1 or something like that. Very specific, a delta shape versus a triangle. And over several minutes, this cloud, that's what it looked like. It was kind of gray in the darkness. That's why I don't know even why my eye saw it. I casually mentioned that this thing was there again. And Ryan had more faith in my sighting than I did, and he jumped out and he snapped a couple pictures. And I'm worried that the local sheriff is going to come up and want to know why we're hanging out in front of these people's houses. I'm like, Ryan, let's get out of here. I shouldn't have done that. I was just an old paranoid guy, I guess. And he showed me the picture on his cell phone, because we don't have video cameras. And it was very distinctly... A acute triangle delta shape, and he took three pictures. It did not change. So I'm pushing him. We drive down a little bit down the road, and I'm giving him a high five, and I notice a light out of my left eye, like there's a car coming up behind us. I'm thinking, the sheriff didn't want to know. I look back, and there is a huge three-pointed triangle craft that looked like it was the size of an aircraft carrier. At first, I thought the mountain was on fire. And then I looked a little closer, and I realized that it wasn't a fire. It was like a light on the nose, quote unquote, and a light on the rear, and a perfect triangle with this orange yellow light. And Ryan spun around and he saw it too. So maybe I can let him give his version of what.
Go ahead, Ryan, give us your version.
Yeah, so as we were coming back after taking the picture of the Delta, and you know, the camera for the Delta that we saw, the camera doesn't know justice. When I was standing there looking at it in person, you could tell it just looked off. But as we were leaving to go back to John's house, and he had said, hey, look back here, and some back here, and I looked back, and the three lights, and it looked like almost like the base was coming down like this, and you could see the orange lights, and they were coming all the way down. And the one regret I because as soon as we turned around, I was almost able to take a picture of it. John was like, no, let's get closer. But I should have took the picture of it. But seeing that was just amazing, you know, especially after going up to meet him and Colleen. And he was like, oh, I haven't been seeing anything up here. And then, you know, I get up there and then we see that. And I'm like, oh, this is just.
It looked like a space shuttle was landing in the lake. I mean, but bigger than that. And I don't think I slept for the next 30 hours. Mm-hmm. And I've got a lot of experience. I did not expect to be scared. Then I made the mistake of reporting this. I made the mistake of reporting this to a UFO reporting agency. And that's like talking to the amazing Randy. Hmm. You know,
who did you report it to?
Should I say the name?
It's
called API recording. And I had noticed that I think it was Ben Henson from a Factor Fiction show. He had commented that only one in 450 sightings gets reported. And I think I know why, because I wasn't talking to this fellow for 10 minutes and he was trying to tell me that my past experience, he gave me a theory of some doctors that talking about, you know, almost like, that your experience can cloud your judgment. You have pareidolia. I have so much background that I start to see things that aren't there. I mean, it's really insulting, and my ego wouldn't let me, you know, admit to the fact that he thought it was a cloud 30 miles away that we photographed.
Well, if I could say something real quick.
Yeah, go ahead.
You know, this is one thing I think about the younger generation and how all of this is progressing is, I think you're kind of raised from a small age, you're from a young age to live inside of this box. And if you go anywhere outside of this box, people immediately call you crazy, or, you know, that you just don't know what you're talking about. And I think sometimes it takes one or two people to kind of come out and kind of show you some stuff and show you that something may be different, and maybe you can open your mind a little bit. And I think people are so scared of saying that they've seen stuff that, you know, I think that's one reason why this, you know, going out and doing stuff like I'm doing, it may kind of, you know, not carry over well with the younger generation, just because they're scared of going out of that box that you're told to be stuck in, you know, from very young age. And I'm just at an age now where I just don't, you know, I want to believe that something's there or something's going on, but, you know, if I can get proof and show you, then, you know, maybe you can open your mind a little bit. I'm not saying you have to believe it or you don't, just, you know, at least let me show you, and then you can make an opinion on it, but don't make a judgment until you've seen, you know, the proof.
And part of the sorry, Willie.
Part of the point of my book,
Making of an Urban Legend, is there is such a cost to people that muster the courage and go into the public eye about this. A lot of folks don't know I've followed your works for many years, the great cost to you for, you know, writing your books and speaking of what you do. There's a certain amount of the population that's fine with it, and then there's a large amount of the population that just tears you to pieces. I don't know how you do it.
Well, also a large part that doesn't care. Well, you know, let me tell you why I do it and why I'm, you're on the air, why I'm still doing this. It was explained to me by my wife many years ago. And I, you know, I said to her, Ann, why don't we just go walk away from this? We're not getting anywhere. And she said, that's not the point. Here is what is happening. My wife, Ann, knew an awful lot of things. She was a genius.
She was so nice to me.
She was a nice person too, very sweet. In any case, even to me, which is hard because I'm not the easiest person in the world to live with. She used to say, well, you know, at least I know one thing. I'm married to the most annoying man in the world. So if another man comes along in my life, it's not going to be as annoying. He's not going to be as annoying as you.
She didn't choke you to death in your sleep. So that's, you know, positive.
No, she didn't have that. But anyway, here's what she said. She said, this is never going to come completely into focus because that's not what it's about. She said, questions that we can't answer and can't leave alone, you know what they do? They increase human intelligence. And that goes right into DNA. And there's somebody here who wants very badly for that not to happen. But you guys are out there facing this question every day and bringing it to the public, and other people face the question. Their babies are born and their babies have higher intelligence levels than they did. You know, the ancient aliens people talk about in the distant past, aliens coming here and altering our DNA. Anne used to say, it's not in the distant past. It's now. It's happening now. That's what all this is about. And that's why the questions are going to stay unanswered. We're never going to get quite enough information to where we can say, okay, this is this and this and this. And that's why whatever that guy, I forget his name, and you don't even need to say it again, was talking to, he didn't understand that. And he's part of the, without realizing it probably, he is part of the process of resistance to this increase in human intelligence. Somebody is here helping us. They're just doing it in ways that we can't understand, but she did understand it. Let's go on now. Where were we, guys? Help me here. I don't know. I've forgotten.
I want to interject again too here, Whitley. You had mentioned that after all these years, we hadn't got a chance to talk again. Now, I had my 15 minutes of fame with my little diagram because I believe now I know more than I did back then, that there's multiple ways that an average citizen can go out for themselves and prove anomalous things.
Yeah.
But in the process, if we had another couple hours, okay, by approximately 1998, I disappeared. The cost to me for pursuing this was I became homeless for a couple years. And I had lost several manuscripts. I lost everything I had in the process of this without giving you the long version. And if you can believe there was something good came out of the COVID pandemic, inexplicably, I had one manuscript that I had written, it took 12 years, returned to me. And I don't know if you remember, you meet so many people, but I met you twice at conventions. And
yeah, I do remember that, of course.
I had about 30 seconds and I was handing you everything, including a manuscript. I know now it was a faux pas, but at the time, what I didn't have the time to tell you was very bad things were happening because of my exposure to this. I had things come in my house. I had
organizations. When you say things come in your house, can you expand on that a little bit?
Well, you know, this is, I'm being sincere and I'm not trying to sell anything to someone. You know how this goes.
Yeah, but folks, do go on Amazon or wherever you buy books and get the Solar Obliteration Experiment. Obviously, it would help him a lot. So, okay, let's go. And plus, it's a very cool, fascinating book you will find.
the story of what a person goes through, because I started out as an unknown, you know, ne'er-do-well, and by the end of it, I had met legends like yourself. I had been on every television show. I got a call out of the blue for an audition, and if you can imagine, as I'm doing UFO conventions, I got hired to be a space alien on a couple network shows. And going up in front of these crowds, and inevitably they want to know what I do for a day job. And I tell them that, and I lost a lot of credibility, but nonetheless, it was very true. But so I had just done the Art Bell show, and I came home one night, and my girl at the time, we're living in an apartment in Reseda, beautiful downtown Reseda, in the middle of the San Fernando Valley. And she tells me, John, I'm very concerned. There's a car outside that I think is looking at us. I feel like these people are stalking. I went over to the window, which was in the kitchen, very thin little window, looking down from the second. And, you know, I'm 100% sincere and honest here. It was a dark blue Ford sedan with two fellas with suits and ties and sunglasses, looked up at me and smiled. I'm thinking,
this is such a familiar story to me, John, from so many people.
Right after I had been on Art's show, okay? And I'm thinking my friends must be playing with me, because literally the Men in Black movie had just come out and it was an exact duplicate. Give me a break, guys, right? So I'm going to run down and come up behind them and say, who are you? I'm going to sneak up on them. I run out the front door, go down the stairwell. Couldn't have been 15 seconds, and this car was gone. And I was hearing, back in the days, telephones were actually plugged into the wall, and I'm hearing clicks in my phone. And then I got a call from a guy at JPL, because he looked at some of my video, and he says, well, I want to have somebody talk to you. And I say, okay. He calls me up, and he identifies himself as, you know, Agent Smith or whatever. It wasn't very funny. He said he was from told me he was from the NSA. And I got a little scared, and I'm literally telling him, you know, I'm not a subversive. I'm just trying to show information. And he said, no, we know that already. And he just basically said to me, what you believe you're looking at is what you are looking at. I said, that's an amazing thing to say. Can you, like, send me a letter, back me up on it? No, that's not what we do. But it really scared me. I'm still not sure, you know, but I said, well, why would you, you know, be looking at somebody like me? And his answer was, well, we got to get our information from somewhere. So I'm about 98%, you know, sure that this happened. And not long after
it was real, you mean? I mean, you know, yes. It happened, but I mean,
he was who he said it was. And then one day, not long after that, my friend Sean Creighton Harrison, he's talked to you before. We're a couple feet away from one another, standing up. My girlfriend at the time, she was a court reporter, and she's practicing stenography. And I noticed through the wall, something ran between us, and I got a good look at it and took a left turn and ran through the back room. And I'm not going to say anything. I looked up at my friend, and he's just locked on me, and he's just turning white. The hair on his arms is standing up, and he started, did you see that? And I said, yes, I did. And he asked me, well, what was it then? Like, he's smart aleck about it. He's expecting me to say orbs or something. I said, well, it was this little gray fella, about 3 foot tall. I'd never seen anything like that, but I could have put my hand on it. It was so close. And, to me, it looked almost like an X-ray. I mean, the stereotypical, and I also want to inject here, before Whitley Strieber's communion story came out, I don't remember the cultural icon of the little gray face with the almond eyes, you know.
No.
It's almost like that was your contribution. I never saw
it. Annie and I brought that into the world. Yeah, that's for
sure.
Yeah,
now there's no one on the planet doesn't know what that is. That was just one.
Wait, let's roll back here for a second. Where exactly were you when this happened?
I was in the living room in my apartment. All the lights were on.
And when
we were
when
talking did this about happen? The subject in Reseda.
In Reseda, but what year?
I want to say that was probably right around the same time that I met you for the first time. You know, and this is what I'm saying. I'm handing you things. 1997, 1998.
Very rough time in my life, boy, I'm telling you. We nearly became homeless around then.
Yeah, people don't understand the cost of deciding to tell people about this, but we are literally having a conversation about this when it ran through the room. Now, later that night, and I think you saw the little cartoon, I was awakened, because I drew a little picture, by a little red ball floating through the room. Back then, nobody was talking about orbs. We didn't know what that was. My first thought was somebody was shining a laser from a gun sight on my wall. But then I realized that it was free floating. And Ryan doesn't know these. I'm going to freak him out, right? But then it did a right turn and it was free floating. It wasn't on the wall. And I'm just, even when I see these things to this day, I'm in disbelief. I talk myself out of it. I'm like hypnotized. Just watch it. It came up alongside my temple and arced. And it was like somebody did an old flash bulb on a camera, blinded my right eye, but my left eye was fine. And I got mad and I jumped out of bed. I went to the kitchen. I'm throwing water in my face. And there was a light beam coming through the window of the kitchen. It was dark at night, in the middle of the night. But then I realized the angle was wrong. And something ran out of this light. And I don't believe these things, Whitley. I have no reason to make these up. I hadn't eaten pastrami sandwich before I went to bed. It wasn't, but something ran out of this light, ran through the room, and I got a good look at it. And it almost like was laughing at my response to it. But again, they look almost like x-rays or a projection, almost like a hologram.
Yeah, there's something very strange about the way they look. It's very true.
And
those little creatures have been in this apartment many times, and mostly that they look like that. And folks, I don't think I can explain it any better than John is, but if you've seen them, you'll know that that's just what they're like. They're not completely in the physical world, or at least not in our physical world, I don't think.
But this thing exited the room right through the wall, running full blast, and it laughed at me, but I almost felt like it was laughing
in your head.
That makes sense. Yes.
Yeah, it does. It makes sense to those of us who are doing this because that's how it works.
If we have just a moment, there's something very serious I want to share with you too. But how's your time? Do I have a moment?
Oh, we're good on time. We're good on time. We're gonna
want to say about
our free side in about 10 minutes, and then we're gonna go on with the subscribers. We lose them in. Oh,
we know it was strange last night.
Wait. Sorry. I have just seen something. On the timer, it is time to close out Free Dreamland. So, Free Dreamlanders, thank you very much for being with us. And I hope you get John's book, The Solar Obliteration Experiment. It's fascinating stuff, full of illustrations, well worth your money. And you'll have a lot of fun with it. And
it's on Amazon.
And it's on Amazon, exactly.
Thank you.
Okay. So... Thank you very much, and we'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.